Good evening, everyone. I am so happy, and it's a great pleasure to welcome you all to this edition of Club Perumbudel monthly meet number 080. I thank Lupin Respiratory People for organizing such a massive webinar. I thank all the participants for your time and your presence. This meeting is so very important because we got one of the most respected speakers of the state with us. I bring to you greetings from Dr. M. Chandrasekharan, our chairman, Dr. C. Muralidharan, our finance secretary, and all the members of Club Perumbudel Dindigul. Our club, Club Perumbudel Dindigul, was inaugurated in the year 2014 January, and right from that time, we are conducting monthly meetings on the fourth Wednesday of every month, non-stop so far, and this is our 80th meeting. This meeting is so special, as I already mentioned, because due to our speaker, Dr. M. Chandrasekharan, sir. And this is our sixth webinar. We are conducting our sixth meeting as webinar, even in these COVID times. And that's possible because of the unconditional support of all you people. But for your motivation, this would not have been possible for us. It's a very special meet, as I already told you. We got one of the best speakers. Dr. Chandrasekharan, sir, passion for teaching is something remarkable, which nobody can match. He has put down his personal life and practice much below the ladder. And he is so passionate about teaching. He prepares so many talks, so many topics every day and presents them in a platter for you. So he should assimilate. That's his trick. And we have seen him standing for hours together and giving the talks. At least now I've been happy that he's being seated and going to talk to us in this way. He doesn't like to get introduced. He needs no introduction, in fact. So I just skip the part of the introduction. He's a MD, DM cardiologist. He's a practicing senior cardiologist in Trichy, Tamil Nadu. I welcome all the other state delegates also to our webinar. The topic today is obstructive sleep apnea, rightly called by our speaker as obscure sinister ailment. So nicely is defined in just three words, the whole pathology and physiology, the prognosis of obstructive sleep apnea. The condition of OSA is increasing day by day throughout the population, throughout the world, and India also, thanks to the globicity. Obstructive sleep apnea by itself is a real risk factor for many of the CV events. It's a pulmonologist forum, but cardiologists are also equally interested in that. Endocrinologists are very much interested, diabetics are very much interested, because more than 50% of the OSA people are hypertensive. And it's an independent risk factor for getting heart attack and stroke and all the atherosclerotic vascular events. Unless you control your OSA and treat OSA, you can't bring down your blood sugars, you can't bring down your BP, you can't bring down the lipids, you can't bring down your fatty liver. All things are just interrelated as a part of the insulin resistance. So tell us about this and more. I hand over the mic to our speaker, Dr. Chandrasekharan. I won't stand in the way. Over to you, sir. Once sir finishes his talk, we'll have question and answers. You can always, at any time, put your questions in the chat box. The question will be taken up once the talk is over. Thank you, one and all. Have a great time. Welcome, sir. The attention is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Shekhar, and good evening to all of you. I bring my best wishes from Trichy to the Club Perumbudel, a unique club organized by Dr. Shekhar and others, and doing meeting uninterruptedly for last 80 meetings is a great achievement, and I wish them well. And I also thank the invitation of Dr. Shekhar, because Dr. Shekhar is always close to us. He's so fond of us, actually. So we cannot say no whenever Dr. Shekhar asks me anything, especially in some academic event. So once again, I thank you and welcome you to this lecture, which I called the obstructive sleep apnea as obscure sinister ailment. So that's why we have given you this topic, and it's actually I'm going to talk to you about the obstructive sleep apnea. So today the sleep is very, very important, because the good sleep hygiene is critical for one's overall physical and mental health. Especially in cardiovascular disease, we insist on the sleep is a very important part of the lifestyle modification now, not only diet, exercise. A good sleep is very, very important. Normally, it should take 10 to 15 minutes to fall asleep after going to bed. And if you are asleep less than 5 minutes, that could be a sign of excessive sleepiness. For example, you start sleeping on my first slide, you have excessive sleepiness. If you start sleeping on my 12th, 15th slide or 20th slide, I think you have a normal sleep mechanism. So the important recommendation today is one should sleep minimum of 7 to 8 hours per day for a good physical mental health. So there are a lot of common sleep disorders. The insomnia is defined as patient wants to sleep but cannot sleep. Whereas sleep deprivation, patient can sleep but does not want to sleep because he is involved in some work, or some pathophysiological problem like obstructive sleep apnea is not allowing him to sleep. So that's called sleep deprivation, which is a problem of sleep quantity. Whereas the sleep apnea is sleepy during the day and snores at night because of primarily the obstruction in the upper airway. It is a problem of sleep quality. So you must have a quality and you must also have the quantity of sleep. And most often this very important phenomenon, restless leg syndrome, is most often accompanied is with obstructive sleep apnea. So it's one of the parameters we assess during our sleep study also. So with this brief introduction, I straight away go to the sleep apnea. So sleep apnea is repetitive episodes of sleep disordered breathing. So a broad terminology for everything, obstructive sleep apnea or hypopnea or central sleep apnea, is sleep disordered breathing, which is called SDB. As the doctor rightly pointed out, it is a significant contributor to many diseases, not only cardiovascular disease, but also many of the metabolic diseases, as well as the muscle disorders like heart failure. So now we come to the definitions of this sleep disordered breathing. When we say apnea, it could be obstructive, which is peripheral, or central. Obstructive sleep apnea is airflow is totally absent, but ventilatory effort is present. That means the airflow is not there, but thoracic muscles and abdominal respiratory muscles are working. That is obstructive sleep apnea. Whereas in a central apnea, what happens is airflow as well as the muscles are not working. Airflow is completely absent. The thoracic and abdominal respiratory muscles are not working at all. So that is called central sleep apnea. Then we can have mixed sleep apnea, where we have component of obstruction as well as the central mechanism. Hypopnea is defined as the critical reduction of airflow, but it is not total absence of flow. So critical reduction of airflow, but not total obstruction to the airflow, is called hypopnea. So there are many, almost three criteria to use the hypopnea. So one criteria is less than 50% of the airway, more than 50% of time the patient has got no respiration. Second is the EEG phenomenon of arousal. And a very simple definition is that it requires 4% decline in oxygen saturation to define hypopnea. So it's a critical narrowing of the airway, total narrowing of the area, which can be obstructive or central. So apnea is the absence of inspiratory airflow for at least 10 seconds. So this is total absence of inspiratory airflow. Critical absence of airflow, once again lasting for 10 seconds, drop in oxygen saturation, as well as electroencephalographic arousal, is called hypopnea. So primarily, apneas and hypopneas are classified, we have said, as obstructive and central. But nevertheless, even in obstructive sleep apnea, which is peripheral, there is some input, then there's some problem in the brainstem neural input to the muscles, especially the airway muscles and lower thoracic inspiratory pump muscles. So although it is called a peripheral obstructive sleep apnea, there is some amount of small neural combination is also there for that obstructive sleep apnea. So we now see what is obstructive sleep apnea. This occurs when complete upper airway occlusion occurs. It is absent airflow. The tongue is falling backward in the face of continued activity of the inspiratory thoracic pump muscles. For example, your thoracic muscles will be working, your abdominal muscles will be working, but there will be a total absence of airflow through the upper airway, especially the obstruction in the upper airway. This is obstructive sleep apnea. Whereas in central sleep apnea, once again, there is absence of airflow, but there is also absence of thoracic muscle movement as well as abdominal muscle movement. So that is called central sleep apnea. In central sleep apnea, the problem is in the pontomedullary pacemaker. It is in the brain. So there is a threshold below which, threshold of carbon dioxide, below which, below a particular level of carbon dioxide, the pontomedullary pacemaker will not produce the respiration because it sees completely the carbon dioxide is washed out. So it has to stop respiration for some time to regain the carbon dioxide. So this is what happens in central sleep apnea. You have a significant drop in carbon dioxide below the pontomedullary pacemaker's threshold to stop the respiration completely. So that's why it completely shuts off the respiratory, the stimulus to the respiratory muscles, and thereby the apnea is occurring. The two most common causes of central sleep apnea are heart failure, and especially the heart failure and opioid use. Now we come to the pathogenesis of obstructive sleep apnea. There are multiple effects. So primarily when we say obstructive sleep apnea, I told you it is likely to be peripheral. And the most important two muscles which are responsible for obstructive sleep apnea are genioglossus muscle and geniohyoid muscles. Because of this abnormal muscle action, the tongue is falling backwards, and they may also have the skeletal problem. They may also have a pharyngeal problem. They also have soft tissue problem of the in the throat. So it can be a soft tissue problem, which is narrowing the upper airway, or it can be a skeletal problem in which the skeletal mechanism or the skeletal space which is going to house these soft tissues is going to be small. So although the soft tissues are normal, still there is narrowing of airway because the skeletal room is less for this soft tissue mechanisms. So it can be a craniofacial abnormality, enlarged tonsils, upper airway edema, decreased lung volume, and majority of these conditions are produced by obesity. So what is obstructive sleep apnea? You can see this is the airway. The airway is beautifully going. The patient is normal. And you can see it is totally blocked here by primarily falling back of the tongue as well as the soft tissue here, soft palate here, and that there is a total absence or critical absence of upper airflow, upper airway flow into the lungs. So now we look at the mechanisms of the obstructive sleep apnea. First, we look at the normal. So this is your soft palate. So the airway, upper airway is divided into retropalatal region and retroglossal region, behind the tongue, behind the palate. So it is divided into two halves here. So in a normal situation, the palate is normal, the tongue is normal, and the most important muscle I told you, the geniohyoid muscle or the genioglossus muscle, is actually in horizontal position. So whenever the patient lies down or goes to sleep, what this muscle does is to contract and push the tongue forwards so that the tongue does not fall backwards. So this is also because of some amount of the central input for this muscle. So what happens? So this is very important. So this action of this important. Then, of course, the skeletal room. The skeletal room is divided into maxillary mandibular distance as well as the length of the mandible. So this region is the skeletal room to accommodate these soft tissues. Although the soft tissues are normal, if your room is small because of the craniofacial abnormalities, still you can have obstructive sleep apnea. So the obstructive sleep apnea can be due to skeletal abnormality or a soft tissue abnormality. So this is how the upper airway is divided into retropalatal region and retroglossal region. First, we look at the soft tissue abnormalities. So what happens is whenever you have the length of the soft palate becomes more, especially in obesity, you can see the normal soft palate here. When the soft palate becomes thick and becomes long, so it is going to obstruct some portion of the upper airway, which belongs to retropalatal region. Whereas here, retroglossal region is normal. So this results in mild type of obstructive sleep apnea. Whereas this is the main mechanism of obstructive sleep apnea, where the tongue becomes bigger and bigger because of the fat accumulation. The big tongue itself tend to go backwards and obstruct the upper airway, both retropalatal as well as the retroglossal region. Not only that, the big tongue now is going to push the genioglossus muscle in an oblique manner. It is going to push that in an oblique angle. Because of the oblique angle, even when the muscle contracts and the muscle is not able to push the tongue, which is very big, and also it is not in the horizontal position to exert more pressure, pull the tongue back to the tongue forwards. So this abnormal angle, second, a big volume of tongue, and third, when the patient sleeps, there is a decreased central input for this stimulus for this muscle also. So because of these three regions, there is a significant falling back of the tongue into the airway, which significantly reduces the lumen of the retroglossal as well as the retropharyngeal lesion. And when you come below, the another important mechanism to keep the upper airway intact is a dilatation of the lateral pharyngeal wall. As the air comes in inspiration, the lateral pharyngeal wall should go out to increase the airway diameter. Whereas in obstructive sleep apnea, because of the fat deposition, significant fat deposition in the lateral pharyngeal wall, no longer the lateral pharyngeal wall can move away, or it can nicely relax to accommodate the incoming air. Whether it is not possible for this deceased pharyngeal wall to increase the pharyngeal diameter. So this also results in obstructive sleep apnea. So these are the three soft tissue mechanisms. Enlarged soft palate, the main mechanism is enlarged tongue, an abnormal mechanism of geniohyoid or genioglossus muscle, and also the abnormal dilatation of the lateral pharyngeal wall. Now we come to the skeletal abnormality. Here we can see this is the maxillary mandible distance and mandibular length. So this forms the room for the soft tissues to be accommodated. Whenever there is a craniofacial abnormality, not only the maxillary mandibular distance is going to come down, the mandibular length is also going to come down. So because of that, there is a significant decrease in the space in which the soft palate and tongue is there. So because of that, although soft tissue, tongue and soft may be normal, because of the small room available for them, they will prolapse or they will go into the retropalatal or retroglossal segment of the airway and can produce obstruction. So we are going to see what happens in a sequence. For example, this is the normal airway which is going through the soft palate and behind the tongue into the lung here. So this is normal phenomenon. Your airflow is good during the inspiration. Here you can see, because of some amount of obstruction of the soft palate as well as the tongue falling backwards, there is some airflow limitation. Patient may be asymptomatic at this point in time. There is small reduction in airflow. Then a severe obstruction is going to produce a snoring. A snoring is a form of partial obstructive sleep apnea. Because of the significant narrowing of the upper airway because of the soft tissues or skeletal abnormalities, when the air goes through this narrow passage in inspiration, it produces the sound that is your snoring. Of course, when there's a critical or total blockade of this airway, by the soft palate and the tongue, the patient is going to have complete absence of inspiratory airflow, which results in hypopnea, or critical obstruction is going to result in hypopnea. So this is the mechanism by which obstructive sleep apnea happens. So when the patient goes to sleep, we told you about the muscle tone, which is also coming down. The genioglossus muscle tone is coming down. So because of that, the soft tissue abnormality, skeletal abnormality, there is a significant blockade of the upper airway. So the patient goes to apnea or hypopnea, which elevates carbon dioxide. That stimulates your ventilatory system, or which stimulates the pontomedullary center. So once again, the patient wakes up because of the significant stimulation from the ventilatory center, and the arousal results in significant increase in sympathetic activity, which is the main villain which can produce many pathological problems due to obstructive sleep apnea. And once he gets up and becomes gets up from the sleep, arousal produces relief of obstruction, and the relief of obstruction is going to produce decrease in hypoxia and reduce in carbon dioxide, and this dangerous cycle goes on and on to produce the changes. So there are four important problems which are going to happen in apnea and hypopnea. One is, there is a gross abnormalities in arterial blood gas, with hypoxia is there, reoxygenation is there, and there is a gross fluctuations of carbon dioxide. Excessive arousals is going to produce decrease in parasympathetic stimulation and increase in sympathetic activity. There is a gross swinging of intrathoracic pressure. When the apnea, there is one pressure. In hypopnea, when the patient gets up, there is another pressure in the intrathoracic. There is a gross swinging. The decrease and increase in intrathoracic pressures are happening. Because of these four important pathophysiological pathways, the problems of disease is happening. So one is intermittent hypoxia, which is, these are the events which are happening during the obstructive sleep apnea. Sleep gets fragmental, apnea, arousal, and goes on, the cycle goes on. We told you there is a large intrathoracic pressure swings. Large negative pressure, large positive pressure. They keep on happening. So the intermittent hypoxia is going to produce excessive oxidative stress. The sleep fermentation is going to stimulate the apnea and hypopnea, going to stimulate sympathetic nervous system, as well as hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis activation to produce more cortisols and steroids. This will produce more catecholamines. And of course, because of the large negative pressure, there may be increase in preload. Because of large increase in positive pressure, sometimes there is increase in afterload. So these are the intermediate mechanisms. So the sympathetic activation and adrenal pituitary activation is going to produce, as well as sympathetic activation, is going to produce high blood pressure, metabolic dysregulation in the form of dyslipidemia and diabetes mellitus. Oxidative stress is going to produce systemic inflammation, and all of them together going to cause a significant endothelial function, which can be also contributed by the blood pressure, diabetes, and inflammation, which is going to produce endothelial dysfunction, vascular disease. And ultimately, because not only because of the blood supply to the myocardium is decreased because of the endothelial dysfunction and progression of vascular disease, and because of this increase in preload and increase in afterload can also contribute to myocardial dysfunction. So with these consequences, we land up with diseases. Elevated blood pressure, not only on the systemic side, but also on the pulmonary side. Systemic hypertension and pulmonary hypertension. Metabolic dysregulation, type 2 diabetes mellitus, and dyslipidemia. Systemic inflammation and endothelial dysfunction is coronary artery disease and cerebrovascular disease. And of course, the not only this systemic inflammation, it is also because of the sympathetic system activation, there is going to be significant arrhythmias because of sympathetic activation. Because of the myocardial dysfunction, the patient is going to go for heart failure. So these are the disease endpoints, especially on the cerebrovascular disease, cardiovascular disease, metabolic disease, hypertension, and also heart failure. So this is how the events of obstructive sleep apnea, through intermediate mechanisms as well as subclinical consequences, can produce significant problem in the cardiovascular system. So there is a respiratory control instability, because we have said that the carbon dioxide and oxygen are swinging, and there is obesity and soft tissue and skeletal abnormality in the upper airway. They produce sleep apnea. So this results in increased sympathetic activity, metabolic dysregulation, inflammation, oxidative stress, endothelial dysfunction, and intermittent hypoxia. So all of them produce the heart disease, hypertension, atrial fibrillation, ultimately end-stage heart disease. Now we look at the pathogenesis of central sleep apnea. The central sleep apnea is because of what we call as a loop gain. So what happens is there is an apneic threshold. Apneic threshold is a level of carbon dioxide below which apnea is going to happen. Below a particular level of carbon dioxide, the apnea is going to happen because the system wants to accumulate carbon dioxide by stopping respiration. So here, because of that, the ventilation ceases and central sleep apnea is happening because of increase in loop gain. So I'm going to describe here. Yes, let us say that one point in time in one patient, the carbon dioxide has come below the apneic threshold. Because of the carbon dioxide is low, the respiration is stopped. So after that, because the respiration is stopped and the carbon dioxide is accumulating, it is going to stimulate to produce respiration. So this response to this apnea has to be normal. If this response to the apnea is normal, so the patient will not go for subsequent apneic spells. So this is what the gain. The gain is the response. How much the response is? It should be optimal response. What happens in patients who are prone to have central sleep apnea is that this disturbance is going to produce a gross exaggeration of the response, arousal response, or increase in ventilatory response. Because this ventilatory response is so huge, it washes out carbon dioxide again. And once again, for this apnea, the response is so huge, then it washes out heart dioxide again, and this apnea occurs. So this gain, the gain of the response from normal, is called the loop gain. The loop gain is nothing but exaggerated response to the carbon dioxide elimination, and which results in repeated episodes of carbon dioxide elimination, then accumulation, and then the apnea and hyperapnea, which happens in central sleep apnea. So in central sleep apnea, majority of things are the same. The arrhythmia is going to be atrium and ventricular in central sleep apnea. It is atrial fibrillation here. The most important symptom in the night, there are two important symptoms in the night in both apneas. One is the nocturia, and second is the nocturnal GERD, gastroesophageal reflux, are the two important things which are going to happen in obstructive sleep apnea and central sleep apnea. Here, most often patient is lean. Here, the patient is obese. Here, you have myocardial dysfunction. Here, the patient may have snoring. Repeated heart failure hospitalizations here. And early morning headache. Another important clinical sign is early morning headache. See, this is a triad. One is the patient has got repeated episodes of the snoring or apnea. Then he can have the nocturia. Then he can early morning headache and midnight GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disorder. And decrease excess oxygen results in dyspnea here, the depression here. So when you look at the risk factor, the most important risk factor is obesity and overweight. The most important factor, it is more common in males, in elderly, and postmenopausal stage. And you can look at the symptoms. It's a very interesting slide here. So 90% of times, the important symptom is excessive sleepiness in the morning. The patient may not come to you with a classical sleep apnea in the night. The excessive sleepiness in the morning itself, or excessive fatigability in the morning itself because of the unrefreshing sleep, must make you suspect the patient may have obstructive sleep apnea. Most of the night he'll be snoring, and the partner may witness the apneic periods. The nocturia is defined as two or more times of urination in the night in 1/3 of the population. And you can see that this is the most important symptom. Nocturnal gastroesophageal reflux symptoms is also very important. Early morning headache. So the triad of symptoms other than the apnea are excessive sleepiness is the one which makes you suspect. Then these three symptoms, nocturia, nocturnal GERD, and early morning headache. are the very important symptoms which will make you suspect obstructive sleep apnea. The history on obstructive sleep apnea is not complete without asking the partner whether the patient is snoring or whether the patient has got excessive sleepiness in the morning, or the partner is witnessing the apneic spells during the sleep, even though the patient may not be aware of any of these things. And in the clinical examination, in addition to all the weight measurement, BMI measurement, weight circumference, today it is very important to measure the neck. Anybody who has got the male patients, anybody who has got more than 17 inches of the neck, equal to or more than 17 inches, equal to or more than 16 inches female, are prone for the obstructive sleep apnea. So when you look at the symptoms, I told you the most important symptom is excessive daytime sleepiness or fatigability, snoring, the night heartburn, and the patient is not fresh in the morning, early morning headache, breathlessness, the nocturia, impotence are very important symptoms. The clinical examination, when you examine the upper airway, there may be a nasal obstruction, adenoid hypertrophy, or a big tongue, or laryngitis. We told you about the collar size, more than 17 inches. The patient may be hypothyroid, mid-segment obesity, and all these things can produce hypertension, heart failure, and edema, and patient can have even acromegaly, which may cause obstructive sleep apnea. So these are the symptoms and these are the signs. Why we are concerned about sleep apnea is untreated sleep apnea multiplies the risk of cardiovascular disease. Twice the risk of stroke, twice the risk of sudden cardiac death, 5 times the risk of cardiovascular mortality, and 57% increased risk of atrial fibrillation. Not only atrial fibrillation, but also recurrence of atrial fibrillation even after ablation. So that is very important to know that if you straight away send the patient for atrial fibrillation for ablation without checking for sleep apnea, and the patient comes after ablation, continue to have atrial fibrillation because you are not addressing the important fact of obstructive sleep apnea. And it has got a deadly association with more than 80 to 85%. The prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea is more than 80 to 85% in patients with resistant hypertension, atrial fibrillation, and type 2 diabetes mellitus. The prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea is to the tune of 80 to 85%. 70 to 75% in patients who are suffering with stroke or undergoing bariatric surgery. And in patients who have cardiac diseases and they are prone for sudden death, the important cause of sudden death, midnight to 6 a.m. in the morning, an important cause of sudden death in the night is sleep apnea. So majority of cardiac patients die in the night because of the sudden death is primarily due to sleep apnea. That's why it also contributes not only many cardiac disorders, but also you can see the obstructive sleep apnea is causing the sudden death between 10 p.m. and 6 a.m. And morning sudden deaths may be occurring due to some other causes, but most of the night sudden deaths are occurring because of obstructive sleep apnea. So having seen the importance of sleep apnea, so the next question is how to examine a patient with a sleep apnea in whom you have to test for obstructive sleep apnea. I told you the triad: unexplained excessive sleepiness, not fresh in the morning, or fatigability. So this is a main symptom which make you alert to look for obstructive sleep apnea. Then 3 important symptoms: nocturia, nocturnal gastroesophageal reflux, and early morning headache. So with this, the 3 important symptoms in the presence of excessive sleepiness in the morning and fatigability, you must test for obstructive sleep apnea. And of course, the partner, you can ask them whether the patient has got frequent nocturnal awakening, there is a snoring, and the partner has witnessed apneas and so on. So at present, without these symptoms, any obese patient need not undergo sleep study, because in an asymptomatic patient, there is no recommendation to screen for obstructive sleep apnea. So the first thing which make you suspect is unexplained excessive sleepiness, fatigability, not fresh in the morning. With this, you are going to ask three important things. More than two times going for the urinal, nocturnal jerk, and early morning headache. So this is good enough. This history is good enough to make you suspect and go for sleep study. So this is a scientific way of deciding that the patient has got excessive sleepiness in the morning. Although you elicit a history, the scientific way of demonstrating excessive sleepiness is called Epworth Sleepiness Scale. So here you have to ask some questions and ask him how he is going to sleep. He will never sleep, or three is a high chance of dozing. So sitting and reading, high chance of dozing. Watching television, whether he goes to sleep. Sitting inactive in a public place. When going in a car as a passenger. Lying down to rest in the afternoon. Sitting and talking to someone, so he suddenly goes to sleep. Sitting quietly after lunch, suddenly going to sleep. And of course, in a car, while stopping in a traffic, or stopping before a red light, he goes to sleep. So with this score, anything more than 10, equal or more than 10, you have an indication to test for the obstructive sleep apnea. So this is a scientific way of demonstrating excessive sleepiness in the morning, Epworth Sleepiness Scale. So the very important test which will confirm the obstructive sleep apnea is polysomnography, which will decide whether it is a central sleep apnea, obstructive sleep apnea, or a mixed form. We have already defined apnea is complete cessation of airflow for 10 seconds. Hypopnea is 50% decrease in flow, or ECG arousal, or drop in oxygen saturation of more than 4%. So the three things define hypopnea. So in a typical polysomnography, which is done in the laboratory, you are going to do many things. One is you are going to look at the airflow through the nose, utilizing nasal cannula, and you are going to look at the muscles. This is very important. Make sure this is the one which decides whether it is a central sleep apnea or obstructive sleep apnea. Thoracic and abdominal muscle movements by the bands, oxygen saturation, the snoring by microphone, and the electroencephalogram, electrocardiogram, body position in which the patient is having sleep apnea. And the most important thing today is the leg movement. The restless leg movement is also one of the important parameters we look at during the sleep study in the lab. So these are the 7 or 8 parameters you are supposed to monitor in the sleep study. So this is a patient typically has got a sleep study and he's got a nasal cannula to assess the airflow. These are the things which are assessing the muscle movement in the chin, and this is electroencephalogram, and you have a monitor for electrocardiogram, and you have the bands in the chest and the abdomen to assess whether respiratory muscles and abdominal muscles are working, and you have oxygen saturation, and you have to see the body position, and you also have to see the movement of the legs. So multiple parameters are monitored in the lab. Today, the polysomnography can be done in the home itself. The home study is very well available. So here we can look at the airflow, respiratory effort, oxygen saturation, but not the measures, other measures of sleep or leg movements. So we are going to see airflow, respiratory effort, and oxygen saturation, mainly three things. So home sleep apneic studies are going to be having good sensitivity and specificity. But the problem is 25 to 50% of patients who have got the negative home study may have obstructive sleep apnea. That's why your suspicion of obstructive sleep apnea is very high. When the home sleep study is negative, you are supposed to go for the laboratory sleep study. That's why it's very important. Patient has got a classical daytime sleepiness, he's got nocturia, he's got early morning headache, he's got nocturnal acidity, but home sleep study is negative. Don't stop with that. Go for laboratory-based sleep study. And these studies are accurate and cost-effective. Now let us understand the sleep study here. So we are looking at the electroencephalogram. Here we are looking at the oxygen saturation. We are looking at the airflow, and we are looking at the muscles. So now it is a typical obstructive sleep apnea, because you can see there is a total absence of air flow here. At this point, oxygen saturation is dropping, and you can see why it is obstructive sleep apnea. Your thoracic muscles are moving, your abdominal muscles are moving. That's why it is called paradoxical breathing. Why it's called paradoxical breathing is your respiratory muscles are working, but there is no airflow. And during the time, you have a drop in oxygen saturation. So here, because of the accumulation of carbon dioxide, the patient is getting up and goes for a normal respiration. At this point, electroencephalography EEG will show you arousal here. The patient gets up and gets relief of the apnea and then goes to sleep again, and the cycle comes and goes. So this is how a typical central apnea, sorry, obstructive sleep apnea is going to happen, and the central sleep apnea is going to be little bit different when compared to the sleep study. What is very important to see, the four important points: drop in oxygen saturation during the apnea, and the respiratory and the abdominal muscle movement during the apnea tells you this is a typical obstructive sleep apnea. Whereas in central sleep apnea, you can see that here we are looking at the airflow here. Absolutely, there is no airflow here, but the thoracic muscles are not working, abdominal muscles are not working. That means all the three are not working, means it is a central sleep apnea. So look at here now, during the apneic period, oxygen saturation is simultaneous and your muscles are working. Whereas here, all the three are not working. But another important point is the oxygen fall in oxygen saturation is going to happen much, much later when compared to the obstructive sleep apnea, where the fall in oxygen saturation is going to happen during the apneic period. So that is the difference between the central sleep study to identify the obstructive sleep apnea and central sleep apnea. Then how should we diagnose this severity of obstructive sleep apnea or sleep apnea? So this is called apnea hyperapnea index. So this index is the total episodes of apnea plus hyperapneas divided by number of sleep hours. That means we are seeing per hour how many apneas are happening, how many hyperapneas are happening. So that's what AHI, apnea hyperapnea index. If it is less than 5, it can be normal. 5 to 15 is mild, 15 to 30 is moderate, more than 30 is severe. So here there is another index which is seen is respiratory disturbance index, RDI. Here what they are doing is apnea plus hyperapnea plus respiratory related arousals. Respiratory related arousals also seen here in addition to apnea and hyperapnea. This is called respiratory disturbed index, and once again divided by sleep hours. So per hour you are going to see what is the three things are going to happen. So the difference between AHI and RDI, here you are adding the respiratory related arousals. So, but primarily the severity is going to go with AHI index, AHI. So when you look at the diseases, when you can see even in a patient with a hypertension, in 83% of patients have got mild obstructive sleep apnea, 30% of them can have moderate to severe sleep apnea. And coronary heart disease, 65 and 38. And in stroke, 57% can have even severe sleep apnea. And in heart failure, 12%. And in arrhythmias, 20% can have significant sleep apnea. So as far as the heart failure is concerned, now we are looking at the heart failure. So majority of patients with the LV dysfunction, whether it is an asymptomatic LV dysfunction or a symptomatic LV dysfunction, systolic dysfunction, or a diastolic dysfunction, or heart failure, reduced ejection fraction, or preserved ejection fraction, or acute decompensated heart failure. So all forms of muscle disease, you are going to have significant increase in sleep apnea in the form of AHI index more than 15 in all these situations. But in only in heart failure with the reduced ejection fraction, your central sleep apnea is more than obstructive sleep apnea. Whereas in all the other forms of muscle disease, your obstructive sleep apnea is going to be more than central sleep apnea. That is the only difference. So during heart failure, this is what we call as a chain stroke respiration. So the chain stroke respiration is an exaggeration of the central sleep apnea, where there is a severe hyperapnea followed by a severe apnea. So the exaggerated form of central sleep apnea is the chain stroke respiration. Typically, you have it in patients with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. as we have said, higher the AHI, apnea hypopnea index, higher is the incidence of sudden death. So these sudden deaths also primarily happening between the midnight. You can see significant happening between the midnight and 6 a.m. as well as 6 p.m. to 12 midnight. So one of the important causes of sudden death in the night is a significant sleep apnea in a non-cardiac patient. So risk of death is increased. Cardiovascular death is increased by 3 times as well as non-fatal cardiovascular events. And of course, simple snoring without apnea or hypopnea is not associated with increased risk. So people who are snoring, so don't be afraid that simple snoring is not going to be a problem if there is no apnea or hypopnea or excessive daytime sleepiness in the morning or the three triad of symptoms I have told you, nocturia, the nocturnal acidity, and early morning headache. So what will be the treatment for this sleep apnea? There are a lot of ways are available for us to treat obstructive sleep apnea as well as the central sleep apnea. The most important is weight loss, the body positions. You have to avoid sedatives, positive airway pressure in the form of CPAP or BiPAP. There are some few pharmacotherapies are available, some devices for the bony abnormalities, and even surgical treatment is available. The most important thing in an obese patient is to lose the weight. So 13% of weight loss decrease narrow nasopharyngeal airway collapsibility in obese patients and after the diet alone, and all had decrease in apnea hypopnea index. And of course, significant decrease in AHI after 26 kg weight loss in obese patients. So patient with BMI of more than 40, once again, significant reduction in the neck fat. We told you the neck circumference should be measured in MRI if the patient loses 10% of weight. Even 8% weight loss can reduce significant oxygen desaturation in the night. So the most important thing is weight loss can give you significant benefit because we told you many of the soft tissue abnormalities like enlarged and thick soft palate, a big tongue, and also abnormal lateral pharyngeal wall, everything is because of the fat accumulation in these soft tissues. So if you reduce weight and remove the fat, naturally the obstructive sleep apnea gets cured. And many times what happens is in a positional obstructive sleep apnea, so this is the one you have to watch in the laboratory, whether the apneic episodes or hypopneic episodes are primarily occurring in supine position only. In patients, during the only supine position, if the patient is developing apnea or hypopnea, the very simple treatment is ask him to lie on the lateral side and give a device on the back so that he does not come to the supine position. So this can be assessed only in the laboratory done polysomnography, where you demonstrate that the sleep apnea is happening only in the supine position. Nothing else is needed. Just a positional treatment is good enough to prevent obstructive sleep apnea. Then of course, the main treatment in patients with obstructive sleep apnea is positive airway pressure through the nose. And through the nose, if you are going to give the positive airway pressure, in my sleep apnea, my tongue is falling backwards, soft palate is obstructing, my geniohyoid muscle is not working. Because of that, I have a significant blockade in upper airway. So when I give positive airway pressure through the nose, there is a positive airway pressure is developed, and this pressure pushes the soft palate as well as the tongue anteriorly so that it opens up the airway so that there is no significant blockade to the upper airway. So there are the apneas and hypopneas are significantly gets reduced, and also you treat obstructive sleep apnea. So the positive airway pressure is a primary therapy in patients who are symptomatic obstructive sleep apnea. AHI gets normalized in 90% of patients while wearing the device. What is very important is not only to give us positive airway pressure, you have to make sure the patient is adhering to the therapy by wearing the device most of the nights, in the nights, most of the time. So the adherence to therapy is very crucial to get the benefit from the positive airway pressure. So they will have more symptomatic improvement as well as greater blood pressure reduction once they adhere to the therapy. A minimal adherence to therapy is defined as at least 4 hours per night for at least 5 nights per week. This is a minimum adherence. Of course, if the patient is going to have this machine for more than 6 hours, he will have a significant benefit from positive airway pressure. So we have two types of positive airway pressure. One is called continuous positive airway pressure, where in spite of inspiration or expiration, this machine is going to give you continuous same pressure during inspiration and expiration. So a disadvantage is when the patient is expiring, when the patient is getting out of the air through the nose, the positive pressure from the machine is going to produce some amount of resistance for the patient to bring out air outside. So this is what a single simple disadvantage of a continuous positive airway pressure, continuous positive pressure. Whereas BiPAP machines are the ones who are going to give a different pressure in inspiration and different pressure in expiration. CPAP is continuous steady pressure, regardless whether you are inhaling or exhaling. Whereas here, BiPAP machines offer dual pressure setting so that in inspiration, they give higher pressure. During expiration, they give a lower pressure. So it is the patients most often will be able to tolerate the BiPAP machines more than the CPAP machine. So the difference between the inspiratory pressure and the expiratory pressure is called pressure gradient. So when should we give the CPAP or BiPAP? So you have suspected because of the symptoms I told you, the three typical symptoms I told you in the night, plus excessive sleepiness, or you can scientifically prove that your Epworth sleep scale rating is more than 10, the scoring is more than 10, then you order polysomnography or home monitoring of the sleep. AHI is less than 5 or equal to less than 5, and the patient, the respiratory disturbance index is also is going to be seen if the AHI is less than 5. Although it is less than 5, your respiratory disturbance index is more than 10, and the patient has got symptom in the form of excessive daytime sleepiness, still the CPAP or BiPAP is given. Even if it is less than 5, the patient's RDA is more than 10 or equal to 10, CPAP is given. It's less than 10, less than 5, RDA is not there, and excessive sleepiness is not there, then you need not give a CPAP. When AHI is 16 to 14, and the patient has got symptoms or sequelae. The sequelae, we have told you, cardiovascular disease, hypertension, heart failure, or coronary artery disease, diabetes. So any sequelae or symptoms are present, then straight away, you can give a CPAP or BiPAP. If the AHI is between 16 to 14, and the patient is absolutely asymptomatic, or patient does not have any significant sequelae or diseases, if he's got a worker on whom many lives are going to depend, like a driver or a pilot, or in those people, you have to give CPAP. Although he's asymptomatic and no sequelae, the person on whom many lives are going to depend, and that person has got this of AHI, you have to give the CPAP. Of course, whenever the AHI is more than, equal or more than 15, you have to give a CPAP. Now, the benefits of this treatment is going to be significant improve in the insulin sensitivity and also the treatment, and the you can get diabetes well under control, and it is a very good treatment for resistant hypertension. So majority of patients with resistant hypertension, you have to look at the obstructive sleep apnea. There is a significant decrease up to the 10 millimeter of mercury systolic blood pressure reduction in patients with sleep apnea and resistant hypertension, and one drug to be used in patient the hypertension and resistant hypertension and sleep apnea is spironolactone. Along with the spironolactone, with a CPAP or BiPAP, there will be significant drop in blood pressure. And pulmonary hypertension is very important. All idiopathic pulmonary hypertensions, you have to look for obstructive sleep apnea. Treating sleep apnea itself in almost in 10% of patients may bring the pulmonary arterial pressures to normal. Whereas if you are not looking at that, this 10% of patients will be getting treatment as idiopathic pulmonary hypertension with the lifelong sildenafil and bosentans. So that's why in any pulmonary hypertension, look for obstructive sleep apnea. The most important arrhythmia is atrial fibrillation. Don't ever send a patient of atrial fibrillation to the RF studies or RF ablation without looking for obstructive sleep apnea, because without looking, you have sent the patient to AF, and after AF, RFA also, the patient is going to have atrial fibrillation because of obstructive sleep apnea. Very, very important arrhythmia in obstructive sleep apnea. So in all AF patients, obese patients, or patients with excessive daytime sleepiness, and any AF patient which is unexplained, you must always go into the history of obstructive sleep apnea. And this is the cardiovascular outcomes. You can see that here, the cardiovascular outcome, the cardiovascular risk is significantly decreased by CPAP or BiPAP only when the adherence is fulfilled. What is the adherence? 4 hours per night, at least for 5 days a week. That only can bring down your event rate, and not just putting and advising the patient for a CPAP or a BiPAP without adherence may not yield the benefit. So the summary of the therapy is, there is a high quality evidence that CPAP or BiPAP therapy, positive airway pressure therapy, is going to be significantly beneficial in patients with the hypertension and obstructive sleep apnea. They are going to reduce further cardiovascular disease events as well as cerebral events. And of course, you have to adhere to the hours of sleep and the days of the week. And arrhythmias also, they are very good, especially in atrial fibrillation. They are going to act absolutely, it is very, very essential to look for obstructive sleep apnea in all patients with atrial fibrillation. There's a significant benefit on the cerebral side or in the neural side. Cognitive function improves, quality of sleep improves, arousal index comes down, the patient goes for deep sleep, sleep efficiency is going to be better, decrease in daytime sleepiness, and patient becomes better and vigilant, and better health status is reported. No oxygen is indicated in any patient with obstructive sleep apnea, because it may prolong the respiratory pause, because the hypoxic stimulus is going to be removed by your oxygen and they may have more pauses. And there are some mechanical devices which can enlarge, especially when you think the skeletal problem is going to reduce the compartment size, then you can enlarge the compartment by giving the mechanical increase in the diameter by the appliances, devices, mandibular devices, which can increase the mandibular length. And also surgeries are available, uvulopalatopharyngeoplasty, where you can excise this and make the airway better. The other surgeries are very rare. Maxillar mandibular advancement is there. And of course, hypoglossal nerve stimulation is promising. But the common surgery which is done when the patient has got a significant anatomical problem is uvulopalatopharyngeoplasty. Bariatric surgery is indicated whenever the patient has got OSA but BMI of more than 35. Usually we say BMI of more than 40 is an indication for bariatric surgery, but in the presence of OSA, even a BMI of more than 35 is an indication. So OSA is going to remit 40% of patients at 2 years following the bariatric surgery. That means you are going to cure OSA by bariatric surgery. So the take home points are, think about diagnosing sleep apnea, always keep looking for it, because it is a very, very common phenomenon. The incidence or the prevalence seems to be less because we are not diagnosing it. We are not suspecting it. Sleep apnea causes pathological cellular changes that predispose to many cardiovascular diseases, heart attack, strokes, heart failure, atrial fibrillation. Sleep apnea may be the cause and effect of diabetes mellitus, metabolic problems, and any difficult to manage patient. Difficult to manage diabetes, difficult to manage hypertension, difficult to manage or resistant angina, or a resistant heart failure, any resistant problems in these situations, you must look for obstructive sleep apnea. Just giving a positive airway pressure will have a significant benefit of problems in these conditions. All stroke and TA patients may undergo sleep study to rule out the obstructive sleep apnea, to prevent the recurrent stroke and recurrent TAA. And the positive airway pressure is going to improve the morbidity and mortality of cardiovascular disease, a very effective intervention. Apart from your medical therapy, it is going to be a very effective intervention to improve the cardiovascular disease outcomes. So this is my last slide. remember the hearts. Sleep apnea can produce significant problem of hearts. H for heart failure, E for elevated blood pressure, A for atrial fibrillation, R for resistant hypertension, and T for type 2 diabetes mellitus, and S for stroke. So they can produce, they can be the cause and the effect, and also the problem of refractoriness in these diseases. And just addressing the sleep apnea through the weight loss, the positional therapy, or the positive airway pressure in some patients, the devices, and rare patient, the surgery will definitely have a huge impact in these hearts, and we will make a better heart for the patient. Thank you for your patience.
Thanks, excellent talk, sir. Very clear and lucid as usual. You covered so many points in this very short time in a detailed presentation, sir. But it's just like saying honey is sweet. What else can be? And there are a few questions, sir. I will ask the questions here. So, are there sleep apnea centers in Trichy? Which hospitals have sleep apnea centers in Trichy?
In Trichy, we have in Cauvery Medical Center. The sleep study is done in Cauvery Medical Center. Certain pharmaceutical companies are offering the home sleep study. So we can contact certain pharmaceutical companies. They are offering the Holter study, 24-hour BP study. They are also offering the home home sleep study. So you have to just give the address of the patient to that pharmaceutical company. They go to their houses and they do the home sleep monitoring, and they give you the report, a detailed report. So as I told you, this is practical. But the home study, if it is, you are strongly suspecting clinically, but the home study is negative, you must do a laboratory study, which is available in private also. In Trichy, it's available, and also it is available in Cauvery Hospital also. It's done. It is very well done in Trichy.
OSA is common in obese people. Is it, can it occur in thin people, sir?
It can also occur in thin people if they have an anatomical problem. So thin people, because they have, I told you about the skeletal problem. I have told you about the this mandibular problem. So craniofacial abnormalities, if they are going to have, they can have definitely, or basically a macroglossia, or they may have an endocrine condition, like somebody has asked about hypothyroidism. I told you, one of the things I told you in the slide is hypothyroidism. Okay. So in this patients also, they can have in lean patient. Most of them, it's because of the anatomical problem. So I told you the pharyngeoplasty is mostly done for that type of anatomical obstructions. That's why in a clinical examination, you have to examine the nose and throat for a significant narrowing of the upper airway. So that can happen in thin people also. It can happen, provided it cannot be a typical pathology. We told you it may be anatomical abnormality which narrows the upper airway.
How one finds restless leg syndrome important, sir, and how to treat it?
So restless leg syndrome is primarily because of the problem in the putamen and the basal ganglia. So the problem is this increased arousals, no? Arousals, hypoxia and hypokinia can produce a significant problem in this basal ganglia and the substantia nigra, which produces that. It is called restless leg syndrome because the patients become, the leg becomes very painful whenever the patient is still. When you're going to sleep, he's become still, he's getting rest. Only when he has to move the leg to get out of the pain. So that's why it's called restless leg syndrome. So whenever he take rest and the legs are not moving, the pain is going to come. So this is a primarily brain related. Even in iron deficiency anemia, it's a very, very important symptom because of the lack of iron in these structures, substantia nigra and putamen. So that produces the restless leg syndrome. And the main restless leg syndrome is to treat the cause. The treating the cause is likely to be, you have to reduce the hypoxia, or this respiratory swinging, the eight arterial blood gas swinging, which is producing significant impact on the brain. So you have to treat the primary cause. Automatically, the restless leg syndromes will go off. So yeah, this is part of, it usually happens in iron deficiency anemia. The treatment of iron deficiency anemia itself is indicated.
That's what.
The cramps are different from restless leg. cramps on the cavern happen during the rest as well as during the movement. Restless leg syndrome la the pain and the discomfort in the leg completely disappear when the patient moves the leg. When the patient moves the leg, it goes off. That's why you keep on moving the leg. That is why you see the movement, leg movement during that sleep study. That is the importance of seeing the leg movement. So the patient is keep on moving the leg. You know that this is a significant hypoxia is happening in the brain, which is a stimulus for the leg to move.
Yes.
So it is sort of extrapyramidal lesion, extrapyramidal phenomenon. This restless movement is like an extrapyramidal movement, no? Extrapyramidal. You remember Parkinsonism? What happens with tremor?
Yes, sir. That's true.
It happens in rest.
It
disappears on activity. It is similar to that. This restless leg syndrome is also similar. It will happen at rest. If you move, it will disappear.
Okay.
So that is the cause of. That's why you see the leg movement in sleep study.
Okay.
That's why the laboratory sleep study is better because it is going to see the position. In home, you do not know which position the patient has got sleep apnea.
Yes,
sir. Otherwise, you home wise you decide sleep apnea and give him a CPAP. But if it is going to be a positional sleep apnea, you have to just give him a pillow behind the back. He is going to develop sleep apnea in the supine position. The simple treatment is to give a pillow behind the back and ask him to lie lateral. The sleep apnea gets to disappear.
Okay.
So that is the advantage of laboratory sleep study versus the home sleep study.
Yes, sir.
So a simple thing will miss. So because home sleep study comes to AHA index of more than 15, you straight away send him for CPAP.
Yes,
so the thing is, he would have developed sleep apnea only in supine.
Yes, sir.
So yes, that is the advantage of laboratory sleep apnea.
What are the usual causes of central sleep apnea, sir?
The central sleep apnea, I told you, it is the loop gain. So what happens is, in patients with a central sleep apnea, sometimes the carbon dioxide below which a particular level of carbon dioxide, the brain will stop respiration. This is called apneic threshold. If your carbon dioxide comes down below a particular level, the body feels there is no carbon dioxide at all in the body. What it has to do, it has to accumulate carbon dioxide. How it can accumulate carbon dioxide? By stopping respiration. So that's what the apnea. So sometimes what happens is this apnea occurs, and what happens is because of the accumulation of carbon dioxide, it will start stimulating the brain to resume the respiration. If this response is exaggerated, so in heart failure, what happens? It is not only this hypercarbia which is going to stimulate, there is also hypoxia because of heart failure. So the response to this apnea or the low level of carbon dioxide is exaggerated. Once the response is exaggerated, it's going to completely wash out carbon dioxide. Once again, the carbon dioxide is going to below the threshold. So it will produce apnea. For this apnea, this is once again you have an exaggerated response that will completely wash out carbon dioxide. Then it will go down.
Yes,
so this cycle happens. So this is the cause of central sleep apnea. And because of the hypoxia plus the carbon dioxide in heart failure, that's what's called loop gain. The loop gain is the normal response and exaggerated response. The loop gain has to be optimal. The response to this apnea due to low carbon dioxide is optimal, so that some amount of carbon dioxide is maintained in the circulation, so that it does not produce apnea. The carbon dioxide should be maintained in the circulation above the apneic threshold. If it washes out below apneic threshold, the apnea will happen. So that is the cause of central sleep apnea.
Are the most clinical sequelae of OSA reversible with weight loss? This is by Dr. M. Jayaraj has asked the question. Most of the clinical sequelae of OSA, are they reversible with weight loss?
See, it all depends on the severity of obstructive sleep apnea. To some extent, you can reverse. You can try always the weight loss. And if the sleep apnea, what you have to reduce is not only the weight, you have to reduce the problem in the soft tissues of the upper airway. So if the weight loss is going to simultaneously going to reduce your the fat in the tongue and the fat in the soft palate and the fat in the pharyngeal region, it can give some amount of relief. And so if it is not responding, then of course we have to go for So a mild sleep apnea can be addressed with weight loss, definitely with the weight loss. But severe sleep apnea of AHA more than 15, with especially their symptoms and also the sequelae like hypertension, then you have to go for a swab.
In which part of the neck should the measure circumference should be measured, sir? In which part of the neck should the circumference be measured?
Next, in the middle part of the neck, sir. The middle part.
Right over high heart bone. Middle,
in the high heart bone.
Any drugs contraindicated in OSA?
Pardon, sir?
Any drugs are contraindicated in OSA?
Oral sedatives. You never give oral sedatives. That's what I mentioned in the treatment.
Yes,
never give oral sedatives in patients with sleep apnea. This is going to exaggerate the problem.
Yes, sir. Another doctor has asked, can you explain CPAP versus BPAP again, sir?
Yes. CPAP is continuous positive airway pressure. So what it does is that it is going to continuously give the positive airway pressure irrespective of your inspiration or expiration. When the patient inhales, patient exhales, there is a continuous positive airway pressure. So this will produce some amount of discomfort for the patient when he is exhaling. When he is exhaling the air, he is going to exhale against the resistance of the machine, which is continuously giving the positive pressure to the patient through the nose. So he is going to breathe out, but there is a pressure from the machine which is continuously giving it. The same pressure it is going to give in inspiration and expiration. So there may be some discomfort for the patient for escalation. Whereas in BiPAP machine, the inspiratory pressure is higher than the expiratory pressure. So inspiration, it gives good amount of pressure to open the airway. Whereas in expiration, the pressure comes down so that the patient's escalation becomes easier because the machine is not giving excessive pressure at this point in time. So there is increase in inspiratory pressure and decrease in expiratory pressure is called BiPAP. Throughout inspiration and expiration, you are giving the same pressure. It's continuous positive airway pressure, CPAP. So that is the difference between BiPAP and CPAP.
So Dr. Gopnath has asked, what's the relationship between OSA and hypothyroidism?
So we have told you that hypothyroidism is definitely is going to increase your weight, and it is also going to produce some amount of neural stimulation, decrease in neural stimulation to the muscle and the fat accumulation. So multiple mechanisms are working there. So the sleep is more decreasing, the patient becomes obese, he becomes more sleepy, and also become there is a more fat accumulation. There is also decrease in central output to the muscle stimulus. So all these things are happening. And hypothyroidism, I'm not sure what you are asking is the percentage of patients with hypothyroidism who have obstructive sleep apnea. I'm not very sure about the number. I think endocrinologists may be able to say what is the exact percentage or the prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea in hypothyroidism. I'm not sure about the percentage of patients, but of course it may be a significant contributor of obstructive sleep apnea.
Yes, safe antihypertensive drugs can be given in OSA, sir.
Best drug will be angiotensin inhibitor, either ACE inhibitor or ARB, because many of these patients are obese, and in obesity, the main cause of hypertension is insulin resistance. So these are the drugs which are going to decrease insulin resistance. The specific drugs is aldosterone antagonist, as I told you. Spironolactone is a very specific drug. I think many times I've told you in our cardiology class that the spironolactone is a very good drug in resistant hypertension, resistant heart failure, and also resistant hypertension, especially when it's associated with sleep apnea. What the sleep apnea does is, once again, we have told you, it increases hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. It is going to significantly increase your aldosterone. It is not only increase your sympathetic system, it is going to increase your aldosterone, which is the one which causes your upper airway edema. The increase in aldosterone is the one which causes the upper airway edema. I told you, one of the causes of sleep apnea. By blocking this aldosterone, not only addressing the cause of your hypertension as the aldosterone increase, which is going to retain sodium and water, it is going to locally also act as a diuretic to reduce upper airway edema. So that's why it is going to be the specific drug in a patient with a central sleep apnea.
Yes, sir. One doctor has asked, how to convince the patient to use CPAP?
That is very difficult, but once they get used to that, and see the benefit, they will not leave it, because the benefit they see, first initial days are a little bit difficult, but once they come out of that initial difficult days and continue to use and see the benefits, they become fresh, their sleep is good, they becomes more energetic, their diabetes gets controlled easily, hypertension gets controlled easily, the medicines are coming down, they are able to do exercise better with any without dyspnea. So when they see all that, I have seen people who are using it for continuously for 7 years, 8 years now without any problem. It becomes a sort of a routine for them. The initial days are a little bit difficult, but definitely once the patient experiences the benefit, he will not leave it. He will not leave it, of course.
Actually, it'd be tough to get used to that.
Exactly. That's what the BiPAP machines are a little better. BiPAP machines are a little more tolerable because of that.
It will cost a little, definitely,
because it has to control the, it has to sense the respiration also now. So it has to sense the air pressure in the mask, and according to the air pressure, it has to give. So inspiration, no? So it senses the inspiration, the air pressure, the mask is going to come down, so it is going to give more pressure. Whereas in during escalation, and the air pressure is going to increase, so it has to bring down its pressure. So it has to correlate with the it has to sense the patient's inspiration, expiration, and according to that, it has to modify its pressure. So that's why.
What's Baryard's breathing, sir? Baryard's, B-I-O-T, Baryard's breathing.
Baryard's breathing. I'm not sure, Jai Raja. You must tell me. I'm not sure.
Sir, one daughter is really asking, is really concerned. Will all the stoners become patients of OSA one day, sir? Shall we become patients of OSA one day? That's what one
daughter is. Snoring. See, I told you the four steps. I told you the four diagrams, no? So when your upper airway gets reduced in diameter, you will start snoring. It is progressively becoming narrower and narrower. We may land up with a obstructive sleep apnea. So I can say, just like our pre-high normal blood pressure, pre-diabetic state, pre-OSA is your snoring. So pre-OSA, you're snoring. So just like our, we say pre-diabetic,
yes.
High normal blood pressure, pre-hypertension. So similarly, pre-OSA is your snoring. So here, it is a warning for you that you are going to develop OSA if you are not careful. So do start dieting, do exercise, reduce your weight, and check your this thing, whether there is anatomical problem in your craniofacial structures. And it's a warning for you that you may go into the, so it's not all with the snoring go for, you know, people are snoring for years and they do not land up with snoring, but it may be a warning that this, if you are not taking properly your weight and so on, you may land up with absolutely this. That's what I gave you the examples of pre-hypertension and pre-diabetic state. So you know, all patients with a high normal BP are not going in hypertension, or people with the pre-diabetics are not going for diabetes if they take care, and it's a warning sign. So snoring should be taken as a warning sign, so that you have to make sure that this thing.
So can you give beta blockers to OSA patients?
Beta blocker will increase the weight. So many patients, beta blocker main disadvantage is increase in weight. For example, you are dealing with a pure hypertension with the patient who has got a OSA and obese, beta blocker may not be a good choice. As I told you, angiotensin inhibitors plus or minus aldosterone inhibitor. When the patient has got coronary heart disease or heart failure, let us say OSA patient has got not only hypertension, he's got coronary artery heart failure, beta blocker has to be there. But the best beta blocker to be used in OSA is carvedilol. Okay. Because carvedilol does not significantly increase weight. It decreases insulin resistance. It decreases insulin resistance and increase insulin sensitivity. So if at all you have to use, but there's a compelling indication to use when you have a coronary artery disease, LV dysfunction and heart failure in a OSA patient. There you cannot deny a beta blocker. Very simple hypertension only with a OSA, I may not use the beta blocker. But this patient has got a coronary heart disease and heart failure, I have to use a beta blocker. Best beta blocker will be carvedilol.
Actually, two doctors have asked whether the loud snoring can be cured by using PAP machines.
No, that there is no indication to use a PAP machine without AHA index at least more than 5. So more than 5 only, there is no indication for using a machine in snoring. There is no indication. Only in sleep apnea, that is also AHA index more than 6 with symptoms or sequelae or more than 15. So with a 6 to 15 with a symptom or sequelae. Above 15 for anybody you can use. But below that, only snoring without, that's what I told you. Snoring without apnea or hypopnea is not going to produce the significant bad outcomes. Snoring with apnea and hypopnea only is going to produce bad outcomes. Simple snoring is not a risk factor, but it is a warning.
So what's the dose of spironolactone in
25 to 50 milligram per day. 25 to 50 milligram per day. You have to start with 25. Keep watching creatinine and potassium. The patient has to have normal creatinine less than normal, and potassium has to be less than 5.5. If the patient has got more than 5.5, you cannot use it.
What's the cost of CPAP and BPAP machines, sir? What's the cost?
Cost depends. The CPAP machine only I know. BPAP machine I do not know. If you have a machine, it may cost you around 35 to 40,000 rupees. Of course, they have to program it and so on.
Okay. So, is the sleep apnea curable or reversible after weight reduction?
It depends upon the severity of sleep apnea. If the sleep apnea is going to be very severe, weight reduction alone may not reduce. So, I told you the numbers, no? It can cure to the amount of, we have told you some weight loss significantly, it can reduce. But if the problem is going to be severe, your AHA is going to be 15, it may bring down the AHA. Sometimes if the AHA brings, comes to less than 5 after a good exercise and diet, of course we can be with the weight loss program. But in spite of reducing weight, you have a symptom, then you have to go for this thing. So it all just like our diabetes and hypertension. Diabetes and hypertension can be cured only by weight reduction. A mild hypertension, mild diabetes can be cured by weight reduction. Similarly, OSA, mild sleep apnea can be cured by weight reduction. But in addition to weight reduction, we have to use anti-hypertensive drugs. We have to use anti-hypertensive drugs. So it is one form of lifestyle modification. But it cannot completely cure. It may cure when it is very mild. Indication for surgery is anatomical abnormality. When you have a craniofacial abnormality, when you have a very big uvula and palatal problem is there, very big uvula, you are anatomically narrowed airway. That is an indication for surgery. Anatomical narrowing. Duration of CPAP and BiPAP therapy, I told you, minimum of 4 hours per night, at least 5 nights per week. That is a minimum adherence standard. If you want to get the benefit, you have to make sure the patient uses minimum of 4 hours per night for at least 5 nights per week. But 6 hours is better.
For lifelong, probably.
If you're able to reduce weight and the things are coming down and with the people have come out of it also after this. So it depends on the patient.
What's the role of pranayama in the OSA?
Pranayama in the OSA is not going to help the pathophysiological processes, which is going to primarily reduce it. It may help for your lung function and so on, but it is not a definite treatment for OSA.
Okay. I think you covered all the questions, sir. Everybody's told is an excellent presentation, out of the world, etc. So thank you, sir, once again for the nice time we had together, for the nice information and the lot of hard work you've done for giving this lecture, sir. If you time for the next assignment, 9 o'clock, it's already 8:30.
So, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. I thank all the panel, all the attendees who have made a great show. Thank you, everyone. And thank you. And I thank again.